why it's a sin to kill a mockingbird.
Miss Maudie?
Mm-hmm.
This is an old neighborhood, ain't it?
Who? Didn't hear Margaret in the town.
No, I mean the folks on the street are old. Jem and me are the only children. This is Dubose, close by 100. Miss Stephanie's old. So are you. And Atticus, he's ancient.
I'm not being wheeled around yet. And neither is your father.
He's nearly 60. Oh. Jem asked me why he's so old. He got started late.
Well, you were lucky. You and Jim had the benefit of your father's age. Why, if your Atticus was 30, I mean, you'd find life quite different.
I sure would. Atticus can't do anything.
Well, what do you want him to do?
Drive a dump truck to the county? Run for sheriff? Farm? Work in a garage? Or something else worth mentioning? Other fathers go hunting.
Alabama was already an old town, a tired old town. In rainy weather, the streets turned to red slop. Grass rose in the sidewalks, and the courthouse sags in the square. Old mules hitched in mover carts with flies in the shade. There's no hurry, because there's nowhere to go. And there's nothing to buy, because there's no money to buy it with. Macon County's recently been told it had nothing to fear except fear itself.
Lack of money is no excuse for the Radleys to let their place go like this. The least they could do is cut the Johnson grass and the rabbit tobacco. But of course, they're Radleys.
According to Miss Stephanie, everybody in Macon has a streak. A drinking streak, a gambling streak, a mean streak, a funny streak.
They certainly do.
But
come out and bring what they can. Everyone.
Why are you taking up a clutch
for Tom Robinson's wife? To tell you the truth, Helen's having a hard finding work these days.
I know Tom Robinson's done something awful, but why won't folks hire Helen?
Well, folks aren't anxious to...
I told you, stay out of town right now, you hear?
Bob Ewell and his daughter Mayella. Good times or bad, they live off the county in a little cabin down by the garbage dump near a small neighbor settlement. All Bob Ewell can hold on to that makes him feel better than his nearest neighbor is the fact that if scrubbed with lasso in very hot water, his skin is white.
Why is that talk? Those are just you.
Well, I'm not surprised he stopped talking.
Well, we have other calls to make. Goodbye, Miss Jean Louise.
About to do, son?
Well, nothing.
see you. Son, I'm going to tell you something. I'll tell you one time. Don't you bother that man.
But why does he care?
What Mr. Radley does is his decision. Now, if he wants to stay inside his own house, he has the right to stay inside, free from the attention of inquisitive children. Now, how would you like it if I came barging into your room tonight without knocking?
That's different.
Is it?
Because we're not crazy.
Yeah, what Mr. Radley does might seem peculiar to us, but it does not seem peculiar to him. I do.
Morale was beginning to get drum tight, and talk was beginning to get ugly. A few weeks later, something happened that made Atticus even more of a puzzle. It didn't have anything to do with the tribe. It had to do with a liver-colored bird dog named Tim.
Let's go back to town. What's your hurry now? Gotta get back.
being a dress and a camisole, young lady. Somebody doesn't change your web soon, you'll be waiting on tables. A finch waiting on tables at the OK Cafe.
What's the matter with her? Why is she so hateful?
Come on, Scout, don't pay attention. So you'd hide and be a gentleman.
A lovelier woman than your mother never lived. It's shocking how Atticus Finch lets his children run wild.
I'm here. We'll keep walking.
came under the heading of "Your folks must be out of their minds worrying." But she ended with, "Well, reckon he could stay on tonight anyway."
Hey, that's Jim.
But I thought I should speak to your parents, so I called them too.
What did they say?
Couldn't have been more agreeable. They said you could stay on for as long as you're not in the way.
I see.
Great! Isn't that great?
Sure it is. Guess they're looking over the meridian for me.
Well, no. Actually, they thought you were stuck at some picture show.
Generally, it paid me right too.
You know, Dill, we're going to be going through quite a difficult time here. It would be good having you with us.
You mean the volunteer?
I mean, it'll be a big help having you here. There's a cotton gems room I think you can use.
Thank you, sir.
Why'd you want me to read aloud to her? Finch?
He is. And he's asleep. Don't wake him up.
You know what we want. Step aside from that door, Mr. Finch.
Here. You can turn around and go on home again, Mr. Cunningham.
Won't do that.
Might as well. Heck, Tate's around here somewhere.
Hell, he is.
Hey, stay some deep in the woods. He will be back till morning.
Indeed. Why so?
Call him up on the snap line.
Changes things.
Yes, it do.
Do you really think so?
He said, you really think so?
Me can do that. I see this.
Scout! Jim, you take Scout and Jim. You go home now. I said you go home. Children certainly don't mind very well.
Okay.
get out this house quick. It's something big that a Negro has raped his girl.
Did you go?
Certainly. Got in the car and went out as fast as I could.
What'd you find?
Well, found her lying on the floor. So I heaved her, she was pretty well beat up. So I heaved her to her feet and she placed in the bucket and said she was all right.
Go on.
Well, I asked her who hurt her and she said Tom Robbins. I asked her if he beat her like that. She said he had. I asked her if he had taken advantage of her. And she said, yes, he did. So I went out to the Robinson place and brought him back. She identified him as the one, so I took him in. About all there was to it.
That's all. Thank you, Mr. Tate.
Any questions, Atticus?
Yes. Sheriff, did you call a doctor?
No, sir.
Why not?
Well, it wasn't necessary, Mr. Finch. But she was mighty banged up.
And you didn't call
the
doctor?
He answered the question, Atticus. He did not call a doctor.
Just wanted to make sure, Judge. Sheriff, now you say she was mighty banged up. In what way? Just describe her injuries, if you will, Hat.
Well, she had bruises coming on her arm and a black eye scar.
Which eye?
Oh, let's see. Her left.
Now, would that be her left facing you, or her left looking the same way you were?
Oh, that'd make it her right. Yes, it was her right eye. I remember now, Mr. Finch. She was banged up on that side of her face.
Would you repeat what you just said?
Her right eye.
No, you said she was banged up on that side of her face. Which side?
The right side.
Thanks, that's all.
Robert Ewell.
Now, you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
So help me God.
Mr. Robert Ewell.
That's my name, Captain.
Are you the father of Mayella Ewell?
Well, if I ain't, not much I can do about it now. Her ma's dead.
Are you the father of Mayella Ewell?
Yes, sir.
There'll be no audibly obscene speculations on any subject from anybody in this courtroom at any time. Do you understand? Okay, Mr. Gilmer.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Ewell, could you explain to the jury what happened on the evening of November 21st?
Well, I was coming in from the woods with a load of cable. Just as I got to the fence, I heard Mayella screaming like a stock car.
What time was that, sir?
Oh, just for sundown. Well, I was saying she was screaming, fit to beat Jesus.
Yes, she was screaming.
Well, I dropped my load and run up to the window and looked in the house. And I seen that black nigga yonder gutting on my mail.
Mr. Dill, you take this guy home right now. Mr. Dill, you hear me?
Don't you want to go home? You hear me? Thank me. It's a
with your daughter?
Yes, I did.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Ewell, you said you're at the window?
Yes, sir.
Did you have a review of the room?
Yes, sir.
And how'd the room look?
All sorts of fine, like a good fight.
What'd you do when you saw the defendant?
Well, I run around the house to get in. He got out the front door ahead of me. I saw who it was, but I was too distracted by Mayella to go after her. She's in the house falling, so I went in after her.
And then what'd you do?
Well, run for head tape as quick as I could. I know who it was. He passed the house every night. Lived down yonder in that nigger nest. Judge, I've been after the county for 15 years to clean up that nigger nest. It's dangerous to live around.
That's all. Thank you, Mr.
Just a minute, Mr. Ewell. Do you mind if I ask you a question or two?
Sure. Go ahead.
Thank you. Folks are sure doing a lot of running that night. Let's see. You say you ran to the house. You ran to the window. You ran inside. And you ran for Mr. Tate. Now, did you, during all this running, run for a doctor?
Want no need to.
Did you think your daughter's injuries warranted immediate medical attention?
I's never called a doctor in my life. Besides, if I did, it cost me $5. Is that all the question?
Nice spot, Mr. Ewell. Now, you heard the sheriff's testimony, didn't you?
Yeah.
Do you agree with his description of Mayella's injuries? That her right eye was blackened, that she was beaten.
Yeah, I hold with Tate.
That her right eye was blackened.
I hold with Tate.
Mr. Ewell, can you read and write?
Objection. I can't see what my witness's literacy has to do with this case. Irrelevant and immaterial.
Judge, if you allow a question plus another, you'll soon see.
Well, all right, Atticus, but make sure we see. Overruled.
Mr. Ewell, would you write your name and show us?
I most positively will. Besides, how you think I signs my relief checks?
Dad, do you think Atticus knows what he's doing?
Well, it does seem like he knows.
For that, I don't know. He can never, never, never ask a question on a cross-examination. Unless you already know the answer.
Yeah, because Matt can answer the regular case.
Now, would you write your name clearly so the jury can see you do it?
What's so interesting?
He's left-handed.
That's it.
What's my being left-handed had to do with it? He's trying to take advantage of me. Tricking workers like Agnes Finch. They's always trying to take advantage of me.
That's all, Mr. Ewell.
But that don't change what I saw. And I'll say it again. I saw that
That's
man.
All, Mr. Ewell.
Mayella Violet Ewell. What happened to you on the evening of November 21st? Where were you at dusk on that evening?
On the porch.
And what were you doing on the porch?
Answer the question. You can do that, can't you? Well, what are you scared of? What was that?
Him! Don't want him doing me like he done Papa, making him out left-handed.
How old are you?
19 and a half.
I see. Well, Atticus is not here to scare you. Besides, if he tried, I'm here to stop him. And just sit up straight. and tell us what happened.
Well, I was on the porch, and he came by, and you see, there was this old chipper over that Papa had brought into the yard to chop up a kindling. Well, Papa told me to do it while he was off in the woods, but I just wasn't feeling strong enough. So then he came by.
Who's he?
That young man.
Miss Mayella.
My paws never touched a hair on my head.
Oh. Well, we've had a good visit, Miss Mayella. Now we'd better get to the case. Now you see, you asked Tom Robinson to come chop up a what was it?
A chaperone, an old dresser.
Is Tom Robinson well known to you?
What do you mean?
Well, did you know who he was? Where he lived? You say he got you around the neck, is that right?
Yes.
You say he caught me and choked me and took advantage of me, is that right?
That's what I said.
Do you remember him beating you about the face? Sure enough, he choked you. All this time, you were fighting back, remember? You were kicking and hollering. You remember him beating you about the face? It's a simple question, Miss Mayella, so I'll try again. Do you remember him beating you about the face?
Well, no. I don't recollect that he hit me. I mean, yes, I do. He hit me.
Now, was your last sentence your answer? Call Tom Robinson.
spies, sir.
That's all right, Tom.
You swear that the testimony you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? I swear.
You are Tom Robinson, 25 years of age, married, with three children. And you've been in trouble with the law once before. A 30-day sentence for conduct. What did that consist of?
Well, sir, I got into a fight with another man. He tried to cut, but there wasn't much to it, though. It didn't hurt much.
And you were both convicted?
Yes, sir. I had to serve the fine. I could pay my fine, but the other fellow, he paid his.
Tom, are you acquainted with Mayella, Violet, you?
Well, yes, sir. I had to go by that place every day, going to and from the field.
Whose field?
I works for Mr. McDee's.
Now, you pass the Ewell place every day on your way to work. Is there any other way to go?
No, sir. None's I know of.
Tom, will she ever speak to you?
Oh, yes, sir. I tip my hand every time I go by. And one day, she asked me to come inside the fence and bust up a ship road for her.
Now, when did she ask you to come chop up the ship road?
Well, Mr. Fence, that was way last spring. And after I busted up, she said, I reckon I have to give you a nickel, won't I? I said, no, ma'am, that ain't no charge. Well, I finished up my work and I was going on home. Way over a year ago.
Tom, did you ever go on the Ewell property again?
Well, yes, sir. When? I went lots of times, sir.
Under what circumstances? Why did you go up inside the fence lots of times?
Oh, well, she called me in. It seemed like every time I go by yonder, she has something for me to do. Chopping, kindling, a total lot of fur.
Will you pay for your services?
No, sir. Not after she offered me a nickel the first time. Mr. Ewell and them other youngers, they never seemed to help out none. And I know she didn't have no nickel to spare.
Where were the other children?
It was all around. It was all over the place.
And Miss Mayella would talk to you?
Why, yes, sir.
Tom, did you ever at any time set foot on your property? Did you ever go on the Ewell property without an express invitation from one of
them? Oh, no, sir. I never done that. I wouldn't do nothing like that, just a fit. I didn't do that, sir.
Tom, I want you to tell the jury what happened to you on the evening of November 21st.
Well, Mr. Fetch, I was going home as usual that night, and Miss Mayella was on the porch like she say she was. But the place seemed real quiet like, and I didn't quite know why. Well, you know, she called me inside the fence and asked me if I'd come out for a minute. So I goes inside the fence and I started looking around for some kindling to work on. And she said, no, I got something for you to do inside the house. She said the old dough's off the hinges. So I said, you got a screwdriver, Miss Mayella? And she said, yeah, I do. I go up to the steps and she beckoned me inside the house. When we go inside, I look at the door. I say, this door all right, Miss Mayella. And those hinges was all right, Mr. Finch. And then she shut the door. And then it come to me why it was so quiet like in the place. But there wasn't a child around. I say, Miss Mayella, where are all the children?
Come on.
I say, where are all the children, Miss Mayella? And she laughs, sort of. She say, they all went down getting ice cream. She say, it took her a slap year to save them seven nickels, but she done it, and they all went down.
What did you say then?
I say something like, that right smart of you, Miss Mayella. And she say, you think so? But I don't think she
around my knees. And it scared me so bad, Mr. Fenton, that I knocked the chair over. And that was the only piece of furniture that was thugged in the room when I left there, Mr. Fitch. I swear as for God.
What happened after you turned the chair over, Tom? Tom? Now you've sworn to tell the whole truth. What happened after that?
Answer the question, Mr. Robinson.
Well, after I hopped down off the chair, she jumped at me.
Jumped? Violently?
Lawson, she hugged me. She hugged me, Mr. Fish.
What did she do then?
Then she kissed me side the face. She said, I ain't never kissed a grown man before, and I might as well start with you, nigga. And she said, kiss me back, nigga. I said, let me out of here, Miss Mayella. And I tried to run for the door, sir. Before I could get to the door, she had her back to that door. And I would have had to push her. I didn't want to push her nothing, Mr. Finn. So I said, let me out of here, Miss Mayella. And right then, Mr. Ewell, you have to start yelling through the window.
And what did he say?
What do you say ain't fit to say? Not for these folks and these children to hear.
Tom, you must tell the jury what you said.
Well, he say, you goddamn hoe, I kill you.
Then what happened?
I don't know what happened after that, Mr. Fitch. I was running so fast, sir.
Tom? Did you attack Mayella?
No, sir, I did not.
Did you harm her in any way?
No, sir.
Did you resist her advances?
Well, I tried to without being ugly. I didn't want to be ugly. I didn't want to push her nothing, Mr. Fitch.
Let's go back to Mr. Ewell. Who was he talking to?
Well, he was talking and looking at Miss Mayella.
Then you ran?
Yeah,
why did you run?
I was scared, sir.
Why were you scared?
Well, if you was a nigga like me, you'd be scared too, sir.
Well, I want the whole lot of you to know one thing right now. Tom Roberts has worked with me for over 8 years, and I ain't never had a speck of trouble out of him. Not one speck.
For link D. You will speak in this court under oath and at the proper time. Is that clear? Jury will disregard the remarks of Mr. Link Deeds. Proceed, Mr. Ashford.
You were given 30 days for disorderly conduct, Robinson?
Yes, Mr. Gilman.
What'd the nigger look like when you got through with him?
He beat me, Mr. Gilman.
Yes, but you were convicted, weren't you?
It was a misdemeanor, Judge, and it's in the record.
The witness will answer, though.
Yes, I got 30 days.
Pretty good at busting up a shift roll of kindling with one hand, aren't you?
Yes, I reckon so.
Strong enough to choke the breath out of a woman?
No, I ain't never done that, sir.
But you're strong enough.
Yes, sir, I reckon I am, sir.
Had your eye on her for a long time, hadn't you, boy?
No, sir, I ain't never looked at her, sir.
Then you were mighty polite doing all this chopping and hauling for her, weren't you?
I just tried to help her out, sir.
Mighty generous of you. Why were you so anxious to do that woman's chores?
Well, she looked like she didn't have nobody else to help her, sir.
With Mr. Ewell and 7 children around?
I say it looked like they didn't help her none, sir.
Then you did all this chopping and hauling for the sure goodness, boy?
I just
deny you went by that house?
No, sir.
She asked you to come in and bust up a chaperone. Now, isn't that right?
No, sir, it ain't.
You calling her a liar, boy?
No, sir, I'm just saying that she's mistaken in her mind, sir.
Tell me, boy, why'd you run away?
I was scared, sir.
If you had a clear conscience, why was you scared?
It wasn't safe for any nigga to be in a fix like that, sir.
But you said you weren't in a fix. You testified you was resisting her advance. What were you scared of? She might hurt you, a big buck like you.
No, sir. I was scared I'd end up in court like I am now, sir.
Scared you'd have to face up to what you did?
No, sir. I was scared I'd have to face up to what I didn't do.
You ain't in there with me, boy!
No, sir. I ain't going to be.
No more questions.
You can step down.
Gentlemen, this case is not a difficult one. It requires no minute sifting of complicated facts. This case is as simple as black and white. The state has not produced one iota of evidence that the crime Tom Robinson is charged with ever took place. It has relied instead on the testimony of two witnesses. Witnesses whose testimony has not only been called into serious question upon cross-examination, but has been flatly contradicted by the defendant.
Now I have nothing but pity in my heart for the chief witness for the state. My pity not extend so far as to her putting a man's life at stake. And this is what she's done. Done it in an effort to get rid of her guilt. Now I say guilt because it was guilt that motivated her. Oh, she has committed no crime. She has broken a rigid code. Society. A code so severe that whoever breaks it is hounded from our midst, is unfit to live with. She is the victim of cruel poverty and ignorance. But she knew full well the enormity of her offense, and she persisted in it. She persisted. And her subsequent reaction is something every child has done. She tried to evidence of her offense away, out of sight. And what was the evidence? Not a stolen toy to be hidden.
her of what she did. Now, what did she do? She targeted a Negro. She did something that in our society is unspeakable. She's white, and she tempted a Negro. Not an old uncle. A strong, young, black man. Well, no code mattered to her before she died. But it came crashing down on her afterwards. Well, her father saw what happened. And what did he do? There is circumstantial evidence to the effect that Mayella Violet Ewell was beaten savagely by someone who led almost exclusively with his left hand. Some men make more money. Some ladies make better cakes. Some people are born gifted beyond the normal scope. There is one way in which all men are created equal. There is one human institution that makes the papa the equal to a Rockefeller, and the stupid man the equal to an Einstein. That institution, gentlemen, is a court of law. In our courts, all men are created equal. Now, I am no idealist to believe so firmly in the integrity of our courts and in the jury system. That is no ideal to me. It is a living, working reality. Without passion. The evidence you have heard, come to a decision and restore this defendant to his family. to now, we might as well give a rest.
And I suppose if Dill comes back, they'll
be back. Oh, they probably will. They'll probably be out and back in a minute.
Things all put him that fast?
So you go home, you do your reading, the three of you eat your supper. The jury is still out, and you come back. You sit up in the balcony with Cal and hear the verdict. Thank you.
Every one of you alive. The very idea of you listening to all of that. Don't you have any sense at all to bring your sister to this trial? And as for you, Mr. Dill, you watch out your aunt doesn't ship you back from Arabian first thing in the morning.
Think I should speak to Heck Tate?
Oh, that's not, Father.
Well, aren't you going to say anything?
I wish Bob Ewell would not chew tobacco.
Well, I'm glad the children didn't see that. When they come back a few hours later, Calpurnia was still expressing her outrage.
I thought you were getting some kind of head on your shoulders, Mr. Jim.
Well, don't you want to see what happened?
Shut up, sir. And Mr. Fish doesn't wear you out, I will.
The jury's still out. Nobody's moved hardly.
Moved around some when the juror passed.
How long have they been out?
Seemed like hours. Mr. Finch and Mr. Gilman done some more talking, and Judge Taylor, he charged the juror. Seemed mighty fair-minded, though he seemed to be leaning to our side a little. Why, Mr. Jim, ain't never seen no juror give decision in favor of no black man.
This case is different. One's a red Atticus.
That Bob Ewell was kind of pleased by something.
Jim, ain't it a long time?
Sure is, Scout, but that would be a good sign.
Look, I think something's happening.
Here we go.
This court will come to order. Children weep. I'll see you.
children.
Do you think it's wise for children, white children, to be seen up in the colored bathroom?
We've made this town this way for them. They may as well learn to cope with it.
At least they don't have to wallow in it.
What happened in court today is as much a part of Macomb as missionary teas.
Well, excuse me. Don't suppose that understood anyway.
Too bad you have to see your daddy get beaten. Oh.
When I get home, I think I'll be a clown.
What, Dill?
Yes, sir. A clown. There's one thing in the world I can do about folks. So I'm going to join the circus.
Like you to know that there are men in this world who are born to do our unpleasant jobs for us. Your father's one of them.
Oh, well.
No, don't know well, Mima. You're just not old enough to appreciate what I just said.
Why don't you stop making folks for the best folks in the world?
We're the safest folks in the world. You know, we're so rarely called upon to be Christians that when we are, we've got men like Atticus to go for us.
Who feels that way besides you?
Few people in this town who say that fair play isn't marked wide only.
Yeah, but who? Who do you want to help Tom Robinson?
Well, his friends for one thing. People like us. We exist too. And people like Judge Taylor and Heck Tate. Didn't it strike you, Jim, that it was awfully odd that Judge Taylor named Atticus to defend Tom? Maybe Judge Taylor might have had his reasons.
That's right, Jim. You do the court appointments of their lawyer. One who's just starting out.
Beginning to realize, aren't you? Little more to it than you thought. Whether the people of Macomb realize it or not, they just paid your father the highest tribute you can pay a man. They trust him to do right.
Then why did he get beat?
Oh, Miss Stephanie talks nonsense. Huh. Yeah, we may not have gotten an acquittal, but we've got something. Now, I was sitting there waiting. I thought to myself, Atticus Finch won't win. He can't win. But he's the only man in these parts who can make a jury stay out so long in a case like this. And I thought to myself, maybe we've taken a little step. A little step along the way. Now, I'm going to my kitchen, and I'm going to bake a cake. And I'd appreciate it if y'all come over later and have some of my cake.
Yes, Miss Maudie.
Thank you.
Mr. Bill?
Yes, I'll come. Thank you. I better stop with my Aunt Rachel. They trust him to do right. Well, I'll be back tomorrow with Kate.
They took Tom Robinson to Enfield Prison Farm, about 70 miles away. Atticus thought he had a real good chance for a new trial. Tom, he just couldn't hope anymore. His old employer gave Helen a job to help support the children, but she had to pass that Ewell place every day, and they shouted at her, and they chucked things at her, and she was terrified till she made Heck Tate go out there and make them desist. Bob Ewell thought he was going to be the town hero after this trial was over, but nobody really believed him. All he got from his trouble was, okay, we convicted the Negro, now you go back to your dump. Bob Ewell's threats got worse. But Atticus, he just went about his business, working on Tom's appeal. Well, then death was among us. First it was Mrs. Dubose. Jim was reading to her, and he realized something was wrong, but just couldn't do anything for her, so he called his daddy, and there was just nothing to do for her. Her pain was over.
That's why I treat her?
She was given morphine from pain, and she'd become an addict. She wanted to rid herself of it before she died. Your reading to her was a distraction.
I never knew.
Her view on a lot of things, dear, you see?
Hello, Finch.
I wanted you to see what real courage is.
Got some news for you, Finch.
Courage isn't a man with a knot in his hand, Jim. It's when you know your lick before you even begin. But you begin anyway. And you see it through, no matter what. You rarely win. Sometimes you do. Mrs. Dubose won. She died clean as the mountain air.
Don't you want to hear, Finch?
Atticus.
What is it?
Got news.
Tell me.
I'll tell you. They shot that nigger.
Tom's dead.
They shot Tom?
What?
He was running. It was during the exercise period. They said he broke into a blind raven charge at the fence and started climbing over it right in front of him.
Oh, my God. Cal, take the children inside.
They put 17 holes in them.
Take the children inside. Didn't they try to stop him? Didn't they give him any warning?
Well, they shouted and fired a few shots into the air. They didn't shoot at him until he was almost over the fence.
How did they shoot Tom?
To them, he was just an escaping prisoner. He wasn't Tom to them.
Why didn't you wait for the appeal?
So I told him we had a chance. I guess Tom was fed up with watching his chance.
Ain't that just like a nigger, the cut and run?
Is there anything more you want to say, Mr. Ewell?
Yes. I'd say there's one down and two to go. Guess who's next, Mr. Finch?
I keep a shotgun loaded with double lot.
But he doesn't have a shotgun.
Oh, I can't believe Bob Ewell'd really come after me. If he does, I'll do it.
Reckon you would.
Has Tom shot 17 times?
Well, there's talk, but I don't know. Atticus, you better be careful.
Twice to go inside. And remember, we have heard enough about guns.
I had a talk with Atticus, but he insisted things would settle down again after a fashion, he said. Well, and they did. The Macon ladies arranged a pageant at the school auditorium with taffy pulls and apple bobbin and the children costumed to represent the county's agricultural products. A girl butter bean, a cow, a peanut. When Jim left the scout, she was representing pork. He was holding on to her hawk. Well, anyway, the clouds had been coming in and out all day long, and I just knew it was going to be raining before they came home. The pageant ended with everyone singing, "Oh, Megan, we will all be true to thee," and children got out of their paper costumes and they started home. Jim and Scout started on their longest journey together. The moon had been in and out of the rain clouds all night long, but when they started home, it was black dark. And there was a silence like comes before a thunderstorm, and someone just walked over.